Good evening, Dr. Kuminedu. Welcome on VH Berries.
Good evening. Please don't call me doctor, otherwise I'll have to start treating you. Just call me Kumi.
Back in July 2019, I recorded one of the very first VH Berries episode with Daniel Arquier, who was an Amnesty International volunteer in France for over than 20 years. And if at that time someone would have told me that I would be discussing with you today, I wouldn't believe it. So thank you so much.
You're very welcome. I'm happy to be with you and your listeners.
So you are a rising climate activist from South Africa, a former Secretary General at Amnesty International, and previously Executive Director of Greenpeace International. And right now, you are involved in a Pan-African movement called African Rising for Justice.
Yes, it's called Africans Rising for Justice, Peace and Dignity. It's a Pan-African social movement made up of trade unions, NGOs, faith organizations, individuals, and so on. Working on the agenda for equality, ending poverty, addressing corruption, and rising to the challenge of climate change. Yeah. Oh, so Africans Rising was actually a dream that many of us activists across the African continent had for many years, the dream of building a movement that will unite people across the boundaries that was carved out by Europe, not determined by Africans themselves during the colonial period. And so when I returned home after Greenpeace, I was very exhausted. I thought I was going to take a break, but before I even got back, I was approached to play the role of setting up this movement. So I was the volunteer launch director and the founding chairperson of Africans Rising for Justice, Peace and Dignity. And in particular, one of the things we try to do is to make sure that we can mobilize solidarity for Africans when Africans are facing threats, meaning we want to make sure that the first voices of solidarity and so on, when a particular country has challenges, is voices from their neighbors, from people on the continent, so that people who are fighting injustice have a sense that they are not alone and that they have people of all across the continent that are with them.
Kuminedu, I would love to retrace the journey of your life because, as you just mentioned, it's all about facing challenges, a journey between exile and coming back stronger, hiding and showing up at the right time. It's all about having the great timing.
Timing is very important. many of my friends would say I don't really have that great timing because I did get myself into a fair amount of trouble over the years. You know, I had a wonderful friend called Lenny Naidu, and we both fled into exile around the same time with other close friends and comrades of mine who were also fleeing at the same time. And in the last conversation we had, he asked, what is the biggest contribution we can make to the cause of humanity? And I said, giving your life. And he said, you mean going, getting shot and killed and becoming a martyr? I said, I guess so. And he said, that's the wrong answer. He said, it's not giving your life, but giving the rest of your life. I was 22 years old that time. My friend Lenny was only 2 years older. But he was wise beyond his years, and he said, no, it's not about giving your life. It's about giving the rest of your life. And I, you know, I shrugged, we hugged, all of us shed some few tears and went our separate ways, not knowing whether we'll ever see each other again. And then less than 2 years later, while I was a student in exile, I got the call that Lenny and three young women from my home city, Durban, were brutally murdered by the apartheid regime. There were so many bullets in the bodies, their parents couldn't even recognize them at the mortuary. So I had to think long and deep and hard about that distinction between giving your life versus giving the rest of your life. And what Lenny was saying is that the struggle for justice, economic justice, gender justice, social justice, climate justice, these struggles are marathons and they're not sprints. So therefore, the biggest contribution we can make is once we understand the injustice of a situation, is to do everything in our power to try to make sure that we try to eradicate that injustice. And so sometimes, yes, there are moments where it's good to retreat, to regroup, and to, you know, kind of reflect on what you are doing. Because as Albert Einstein once said, you know, the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting to get different results. Now, for activism, and to be honest with you, if I reflect on my life, I can put up my hand and say, you know, I'm insane because I've been largely doing the same thing. So this moment that we find ourselves in as a global community right now, we have to recognize firstly that we are probably living in the most consequential decade in humanity's history. What we choose to do right now with our economic system, our energy system, food system, transport systems, and so on, will determine what kind of future we'll have or whether our children and their children will have a future at all. And I do not believe I'm being dramatic based on what the science is saying with regard to climate. So when we are faced with this level of challenge, it requires participation of everybody to try to forge forward and create an option for humanity to continue to survive on this planet. And by the way, you know, you probably heard people like me and a whole bunch of other people in the environmental field say, save the planet, save the planet, save the planet. The truth is, actually, the planet is just fine. The planet does not need saving. Because think about it, if we go on this pathway that we're on, the end result will be we destroy our water, we destroy our soil, it gets so hot we cannot grow food. The end result is we will be gone, the planet will still be here. And the truth be told, once we become extinct as a species, the forest will recover, the ocean will replenish, and so on. So to be clear, the struggle to avert catastrophic climate change is nothing less and nothing more than trying to protect our children and their children's futures.
And Kuminedu, your parents gave you this life back in 1965 in a city called Durban, which is the third most populous city in South Africa after Johannesburg and Cape Town.
Correct. Great. Yeah, I know. Durban is my home. I'm very proud of coming from Durban, even though we have many, many challenges and so on. So, yeah, you know, Durban is apartheid, social engineering, all over the place, divide and rule, people on different races put in different places. Best areas for the white community, those people shut out otherwise. And right now, obviously, things have changed since the liberation struggle. But it's important, you know, how I always say to people, if you don't know where you came from, you don't know where you want to go to. So Durban is my like anchor, you know, it's where many of my very best friends are, where my family, extended family is, as well as my two surviving siblings, my brother and sister are there. And it's also the place that taught me most of what I know now. You know, I've had the benefit of education from, you know, good institutions. But I would say that most of what I find most useful in terms of what I use in my life today as an activist is really stuff that I learned from my period as a grassroots community organizer in Durban when I was growing up.
And back in South Africa, you lived through a period that was called the apartheid. And when you were 15, you organized some events to protest and you got kicked out.
I like the way you said you got kicked out. Yeah, I got kicked out. Yes, my first protest against the formalized system of racial segregation known as apartheid in South Africa was participating in a national student uprising. I was from one city, but it was a national student uprising. I got involved when I was 15, didn't fully understand all the nitty-gritty of how to organize, mobilize, the law, the politics, and so on. In fact, the slogan at the front of the march was, "We want equality." By the time the slogan got to the back of the march, the younger kids were chanting, "We want a color TV," because they thought that's what we were chanting at the front. And if I'm brutally honest, I probably wanted equality and a color TV equally at that time. Because kids in white schools had color TVs and kids in black schools had no TVs. But it's amazing, you know, and I'm seeing this with the young people in the climate movement. I mean, I'm astounded at their sort of skill, their wisdom, their knowledge. I listen hard to what they say and do. I learn from them. And when I was young, I never sort of thought I was older of any major wisdom or knowledge and so on. But you go with your instinct, right? But what I had was also the benefit of my dad and mom being very community oriented. And my dad was very actively involved in the sporting associations and community bodies and so on. Not in anything that you could term resistance politics or anti-apartheid politics, but always, you know, supporting bringing the community together and helping people and so on. But what you learn from that, especially if it's in a working class sort of context, you meet people of so many different backgrounds. You learn to deal with diversity. You learn tolerance. You learn to be less judgmental. Lots of things that I think just sometimes when you grow up in extreme privilege, you don't get the benefit to being exposed to. So I'm grateful for that upbringing. Durban's just a nice place. If people haven't visited, I recommend you go visit once they get green aviation fuel sorted out.
Kuminedu, the reason why I called you doctor at the very beginning, it's because years after this event, you got a scholarship and you went to study in England, in Oxford, to get a PhD.
That's true, and it's very kind of you to have said it in such a positive way. But let me just tell you something. The most impressive academic thing I did at Oxford was that I took the longest, apparently, to ever complete a doctorate. I started in 1997, and I finished in 1987, and I finished in the year 2000 when I graduated. So it was like about more than 10 years. Oxford was obviously a complete culture shock for me. The privilege and the and the sense of confidence that people had. And I never had thought myself before I went to Oxford as a person lacking in confidence. But when I got to Oxford, I felt, when I was like overwhelmed with privilege around me at that time, I felt pretty overwhelmed. But thankfully, there were lots of good people I met there. And some of them remain close friends up to this day. It was a difficult time because my friend who I mentioned, Lenny, got murdered, you know, a year and a half after I got to Oxford. My brother was in prison, got arrested shortly after Lenny was murdered, and so on. And lots of friends and comrades of mine were either being killed or in prison. So at that level, it was like quite a difficult time not to be home. But we did what we could to build the international solidarity movement from outside. And I got to say, though, you know, when you look at your own society from a distance, it's an education in itself, right? I mean, even if you live in one city and you go live in another city for 6 months or another rural area of your own country, your place back home looks completely different after that 6 months. Many things that you took for granted and you never, you know, thought much about it suddenly has deeper meaning. And sometimes when people don't know your context, they will ask you questions that only a stranger would ask. Like, for example, I grew up in a township called Chatsworth, right? And it was always called Chatsworth. I grew up with it being called Chatsworth. And when I got out of the country for the first time, I got asked, why is your township called Chatsworth? And I was like, whoa, why is my, must be some named after some white colonialist, but beyond that, I couldn't tell you why it was called Chatsworth and how it came to be, you know, named that way. So there is something really useful and positive to be away from your own context for your own learning, for your own, you know, confirmation of your identity, your sense of being and your sense of place in society and so on. I think it's a privilege, obviously. Many, many, many people, majority in the world, never get a chance to leave their context. And that's why I say that, you know, part of the things that we need to do in the world is to try to equalize things much, much more so that more people can share in an equitable way in terms of the many benefits there is to be seen in this world. But obviously, this can only happen when we are able to deal with the existential crisis that we're facing, which is the fact that we are seriously running out of time to avert the climate crisis.
And Kumi Naidu, through your career at, for example, Greenpeace International and Amnesty International, you met numerous world leaders and influential personalities. And through all these years, right now in 2021, what is your definition of activism?
Activism for me is essentially an act of hope. It is about human beings saying, we refuse to accept that the world we live in is the best that humanity can create for itself. It's about people saying that it's not acceptable that some people can live in mansions and have 12 to 20 homes that they don't use, and that there are people who are completely homeless. It's about saying that we are not willing to accept that we can live in a world where we are being told by the scientists that we are running out of time and that we have to change the way we run our societies if we are to protect our children and their children's futures. And activism refuses to accept that we can just let something like that happen. So sometimes, you know, there are many activists who will take up courses in various parts of the world over history and might never see victory. But I think there is something very different about the moment we're in. And it's this moment that actually calls for a redefining of activism. Because the scale of change that we need to engage in right now is not baby steps in the right direction or incremental tinkering or rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic while humanity sinks. Because we've dragged our feet on respecting what the science has said since 1992 when the first climate conference was held, we are now in a situation where we have to engage in massive systemic and structural changes, by which I mean, you know, like if you take the approach of our leaders after the global financial crisis in 2008 and 2009, it was all about system protection, system maintenance, and system recovery. What was needed then and what is even more urgently needed now is system innovation, system transformation, and system redesign. And, you know, the person that I get a lot of inspiration from is Martin Luther King. For example, when he was speaking in 1965, he said, "My friends, as I come to the end of my speech, I want to note that in the field of modern child psychology, there's a very dominant term called maladjusted. Now, all of us want to live a well-adjusted life and not suffer from schizophrenia or other mental illnesses. But my friends, I say to you, there are certain things in our world that are so unjust and immoral that good, decent people should refuse to be well-adjusted to." He then goes on to say, "I never intend to adjust myself to racial discrimination, religious bigotry." And on the economy, he says, "I never intend to adjust myself to economic conditions that will take necessities from the many to give luxuries to the few when millions of God's children are smothering in an airtight cage of poverty in an affluent society." So, unquote. Sorry, that a lot of what I was just saying was all Martin Luther King's words. If it sounded eloquent, it wasn't mine. It was his wisdom. So activism is about wanting to make the world a more just, more fair, more inclusive, more equitable world. That's my definition. But it also means that you can be working in, as far as I'm concerned, and this is my definition of activism today, is you don't have to be working full time for Greenpeace or Amnesty or any other organization to be an activist. In fact, many activists have normal lives with normal jobs and do the activism on top of their normal lives. And so today, whether, you know, irrespective of the skill you have or whether you think you don't have any skills, we need to figure out an enabling environment for everybody to be able to participate, from tree growing campaigns to building decentralized renewable energy utilities where government is not moving, to look at how we use our bank accounts and organize people who bank in the same place, for example, to say to their bank managers and the owners of the banks that we are actually the owners of the banks. Without us putting money in your bank accounts, there won't be any banks. So we don't want you to use our money to invest in the death of our children by supporting, you know, fossil fuels and deforestation and so on. So basically, there's a possibility here for people to contribute. I believe there are multiple pathways of people to participate, and everybody needs to be an activist today. I don't think activists is, you know, just people who are doing it on a full-time basis. Important though that is.
Kumi Naidoo, when I'm hearing your words, your own words, I can feel the emotion and the intensity. And I can make a parallel with someone, a very important figure that you had the opportunity to meet in your close circle, which is Nelson Mandela.
Well, one of the biggest privileges, I guess, of many South Africans, who, especially who had the chance to meet Nelson Mandela, was that we were meeting somebody who we shared a citizenship with. We were people from the same country, which is just an amazing thing to say, that we had a leader who was put in prison for 27 years, who came out of prison with no grudge, with love and respect for everybody, and with a deep sense of and thirst for seeking justice. He did one term in as president, and he tried to set the example to other leaders across the world that you don't stay in power too long. And after 5 years, even though he could easily have spent another 5 years as president, he stepped back, but he didn't stop. He continued working for justice. I had the honor and privilege to launch the global Make Poverty History sort of event in Trafalgar Square in January or February of 2005. And before that, I had the privilege of being with him when we launched the National Men's March Against Violence on Women and Children in South Africa at that time. And of course, I've had other occasions as well where being in his presence was always humbling. But what I liked about him was he recognized that people had put him on a pedestal, and he consciously, like any good leader, was trying to bridge the gap between leader and the led. You know, I'll give you an example. Once I had taken a group of, when I was working in adult literacy and literacy promoting, basic reading and writing, because one of the worst legacies left by the apartheid system was leaving the majority of our people unable to read and write. And so I turned my energies to addressing this problem instead of going into government after democracy was achieved. And so on International Literacy Day, 8th of September 1995, I believe it was, I took some young people and some adult learners to go and meet with Madiba, as we affectionately called him. And he was a little bit late at the cabinet meeting, not very long. He kept us waiting for about 15 minutes. And he came out, and while we were waiting for him, you know, especially the young kids were like rehearsing the lines, you know, about what they would say when they see him. So like quite a few of them came up to me and said, "So Kumi, is it okay if, like, I say to him, 'Thank you, Mr. President. We know how busy you are. Thank you for taking time to see us.'" So I said, "Yeah, if you get a chance, that's very good. Say it, no problem." And guess what happened? When Mandela arrives, he says, "Hello, everybody. How are you all? I'm so sorry to keep you all waiting. I know how busy all of you are. Thank you for taking time out of your schedules to come and see me. I appreciate it so much." And he took away the lights. He took away the lights of the kids and the adults were going to say to him, right? And in that one moment, you know, the distance between leader and led shrunk a little bit. You know, I'm not saying it was wiped out, but it shrunk, you know, because everybody started laughing because we knew that, of course, we didn't mind waiting 15 minutes for him. We waited 27 years for him to come out of prison, waiting 15 minutes for him. Being late from a cabinet meeting was not the worst crime at all. So, yeah, Mandela sort of was always keen to say whenever he could that, you know, he's a human being, he's made mistakes, he's not perfect, but notwithstanding all of that, we all had an obligation to do as much as we can do. And one of the things, much as we can do to make the world a better place. And, you know, there's a quote that's attributed to him where he supposedly said, it always seems impossible until it is done. It always seems impossible until it's done. So, you know, almost every campaign I was involved in ever since I was 15, when we started, I never thought we had a high chance of winning. But, you know, thankfully in most cases, we eventually succeeded in not winning the full thing that we were fighting for necessarily, but moving society forward. And in that sense, you know, Mandela had a sense that the struggle to rebuild South Africa had only just started, and as many challenges, and hopefully, I hope that all of us in South Africa and people who have supported us around the world will make sure that we can not betray his legacy, because things are not going that well in South Africa at the moment.
Absolutely, Kumineido, because to give some context about what you just mentioned, after Nelson Mandela's release from prison in 1990, you returned to South Africa and you participated to work on the legalization of the African National Congress.
Correct. Because basically the ANC had been banned in 1960, and we had various organizations that, you know, were emerging to support the ANC from time to time. But, and what the government used to call front organizations. But the ANC, as the ANC, never existed since 1960, as were other organizations that were banned, such as the Pan-Africanist Congress, the South African Communist Party, and others. And you know, as we've learned the hard way, being a liberation movement is one thing, being a political party is another thing, you know. And sadly, the truth is there are very few examples where you can say a national liberation movement excelled in power, you know, because I do think genuinely the skills and expertise and so on and so on needed is somewhat different. So unless you're willing to change your mindset, you can't go into those institutions and try to try to run them as if you are still in a freedom struggle. I went back, I played a role, I went back immediately after Mandela was released, and I worked in the adult literacy campaign, and then during the elections, I was an official of the Independent Electoral Commission, which ran the elections, because once I made the decision to take on the leadership of the National Literacy Movement, I felt it was not appropriate for me to be in any political party, because there were people in the adult learning community who were from all different backgrounds. So I did not continue to be an active member of the ANC and then stepped down and focused on building the adult education movement. And so during the elections, I ended up being the head of training for the electoral staff, which was crazy. You cannot believe how crazy that was. I was suddenly, at the age of 29, responsible for training 300,000 people to run the first democratic election in South Africa. I'd never done anything on that scale before. I never even voted in my life before. And then suddenly I was having this major responsibility, which was a great opportunity and privilege, and worked really hard and, you know, made many mistakes, I'm sure, but overall we delivered a decent first democratic election. And then I continued to stay out of government. There were lots of, you know, approaches for various jobs in different government positions. But there was a joke that we used to say then, the term NGO in the first years after democracy stood for next government official, not non-governmental organization, because so many people were moving from the NGO sector into government. And so I stayed out and then went on to try to rebuild the rebuild the civil society sector when I became the executive director of the South African NGO Coalition.
One topic, Kuminedo, that I would love to discuss with you is the COP26 that just ended a couple days ago. It was held in Glasgow in the United Kingdom, and you were there.
Yeah, there was somebody on Twitter who put it this way. He said, it's not that the COP was good and could have been better. It was bad. It was very bad, but could have been worse, right? Which is sadly quite an accurate state of the world right now. So on the downside, as the Secretary General of the United Nations said, the rich nations didn't deliver the $100 billion to support poor countries for the transition. We did not get the level of targets. We need to be under 1.5 in terms of where we're managing things. Right now, it looks like we'll be at 2.7 degrees, which is terrible, because for people already, bear in mind, we're at 1.1 degrees now, right? And at 1.1 degree, right, we're already seeing such extreme weather events, okay? But once we move to 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, it's going to get substantially worse. So already at 1.1, we are in trouble. So we should be like saying, let's just not get closer to 1.5 at all. But that's where we are headed to. And according to the commitments made by governments, we are guaranteed to be heading to 2.7 degrees. So, you know, when I was at Greenpeace, I heard a slogan in 2015 in the Pacific, which went 1.5 to stay alive, 1.5 to stay alive. And 6 months later, I met the same young people that taught me that slogan, which brought tears to my eye, when we were at the Paris climate negotiations, which was in 2015. And they asked me to come and speak at an event they were organizing. And while I was there, I was about to start 1.5 to stay alive. And they went, no. The slogan has changed. And the new slogan, which is the slogan today, is 1.5, we might survive. 1.5, we might survive. So it's important that we recognize that there were like some announcements that were made which tried to create a sense that we were winning, but no, we're still far away. There's a gap, you know, the gap between what the science and extreme weather events are saying on the one end and where the economics and politics are is far too wide apart. And yes, we made some progress, because after Paris, we were heading for a 3.7 degree world. In 5 years, we managed to increase ambition. But the most important victory that was won was pushed by the countries that are most vulnerable, called the Vulnerable Climate Forum. And these are the most poorest and vulnerable countries. And they said, no, given that we have not got the deal that we want here, what we want is to see an annual review of the commitment. So from next year, every COP ideally will be a place where governments will come and be saying, okay, we can now improve our ambition. We can improve it in this way and that way and so on, so that we each year, as fast as possible, bring down the targets to 1.5 1.5 or below 1.5 if possible. By the way, I should tell you, do you know who is the, which was the largest delegation at the COP?
Yours?
No. Normally it's the host government, right?
Sure.
Normally it's so the UK government had 250 delegates, right? And the largest delegation was twice the size of the UK government's delegation. And it was the fossil fuel industry, the oil, coal, and gas companies, the very industries that are the biggest drivers of climate change, right?
Mm.
And you know how absurd that is? That's like, say, Alcoholics Anonymous is holding a global conference, and the largest delegation to the Alcoholics Anonymous conference is the alcohol industry.
Mm.
But bear in mind, one of the reasons why we're not making so much progress on climate is that the oil, coal, and gas companies and other polluting industries not simply have a huge influence of our governments. I would put it more strongly than that. In many cases, they virtually own our politicians. And that is why we have not been able to make the transitions as fast as we need to make them. And let's hope that the growing mobilization of young people in particular brings the kind of much needed urgency to the conversation that is critically needed for us to be able to make the changes that we can make. It's within our capability to make. And you know, the politicians and people at large need to recognize that nature does not negotiate. We cannot change the science. All we can do is change political will. And we need to change the will of our politicians to get a backbone, to stand up, to say we need to make a transition to a clean energy system based on solar, wind, wave, geothermal, and so on. And we can do that also in a way that generates jobs, new jobs in larger numbers and so on than the current number of jobs created by the fossil fuel industry. So if we do this well, we can have a solution for climate, but also a solution for our economic prosperity, but also doing the economic development in a way where we reduce the levels of inequality that exist in society, where there's far too big gaps in the wealth inequalities that exist in virtually every country in the world.
Kuminedo, before we jump into your podcast and the Robert Bosch Academy, I'm wondering, how was the energy in the room and what was your personal goals and objective? Because you are always wearing many hats.
So at the COP this time, it was a privilege not to be there representing a large organization like Greenpeace or Amnesty, because that means like from 6 in the morning virtually you in meetings till late in the evening, and also you just seem to be running around in circles all the time, and you know, just being able to think strategically and so on is so difficult. But this time around I was there supporting the work of the Water and Sanitation for All Alliance. It's a multi-stakeholder partnership of United Nations Development Programme, governments, business, civil society, and so on, trying to address the issue of water and sanitation. And we were trying to make the link between climate and water and sanitation. And it's sad to see that some things that seem obvious to many people seem like such a mystery to others. I mean, water is the most precious resource on our planet. It's not oil, it's not money, it's nothing. It's water. And then, you know, you look at sanitation. Now, sanitation is a very polite middle-class word, which says that more than half the people on our planet don't have a decent place to piss and shit, right? I want to say those words because maybe that can make it real for for people. Basically half the population of our planet doesn't have, and about 500 people have absolutely no place to, so that situation could get worse if we don't address it thoughtfully. And so that was that. I mean, basically, you know, what is helpful about convening like COP is it is a place to present alternative perspectives from those that are being talked about within the negotiations. And what I found was the ideas, the perspectives, the energy, the passion of the people who didn't have accreditation to be inside the negotiations was where reality was. It's where people have a sense of we need to make big change, we need to make it fast, we need to build unity and love, not hate and division and all of that stuff. They are there, you know, with the perspectives that I think are critically needed. Now, the folks inside, it's not as if they don't have the same perspectives in broad terms, but the sense of urgency and pace is completely different, right? The folks outside are saying, listen to the science. The science is saying in 10 years or less than 10 years now, we need to get emissions to peak and start coming down drastically. We're not there yet, and the job is not done yet. So what I'd say to young people, though, or everybody who's feeling any sense of disillusionment, the fact that we've got this annual review is a big deal. Let's make sure we keep the pressure. Let's not wait till next year's COP. We need to recognize that every day moving forward right now has to be one where as many people as possible participate, because it's this, as I say, it's not about saving the planet. It's about saving humanity's capability to live on the planet. So I just want to say one thing, though, right? The hundreds of negotiators in the process, decent, good people, trying the best to move forward the agenda. And I just want to be clear that they deserve our respect, right? They're trying to make a broken system work, right? They're trying to make a broken system work, and a system where power is so unequally divided and so on. And none of what I say should be treated as disrespect for the people who struggle through the negotiations and try to deliver the best outcomes. But when the game is rigged against poor countries and poor people, however good a negotiator you can be, you're only going to get so far.
Kuminedo, the issue around water is crucial, and it was the subject on the latest episode of your podcast called The Triple P, Power, People and Planet. And while the access to water and sanitation is part of the human rights since July 2010, this is not the case everywhere on Earth.
Well, sadly, it's not simply that it's not the case everywhere on Earth. Large numbers of people do not have access to clean drinking water. You know, we're talking about in the hundreds of millions in different regions across the world. And water should be understood as the basic of human rights, right? And the absence of water means that health impacts are devastating. People get illnesses they shouldn't. Growth of children can be, you know, delayed and so on. So, water, you know, when I was a student at Oxford, I had a poster that would said something like, only when the last tree was cut, the last river has been polluted, the last fish has been caught, will humanity realize that we cannot eat money, right? And so this is a moment for us to think deep about big changes and so on. And I don't believe that where we are right now, that we are winning fast enough or quick enough. And I think part of that mistake is the environmental movement itself, in the sense that we have not made it as human-centric as we needed to make it. Right? You know, so if we were talking about water, about soil and land, rather than just talking about climate itself, it brings it closer to people's daily lived realities, especially water. So that's part of what I think. When we, much as I'm advocating for the access of water, that everybody should have access to water and sanitation, and we need the global system to deliver that, I think by focusing on water especially, we can also help show how the climate is impacting on water, and in that sense get people to recognize what a big threat the challenge of climate change is.
And in this very special, frank and powerful conversation with Katharina de Albuquerque, which is the CEO of Sanitation and Water for All, you are explaining that, from what I've understood, that this is a domino effect, because water and sanitation is impacting every part of the human development, starting with the education, health, and the national prosperity.
Absolutely. You said it perfectly. I don't want to even add to that. but yes, you said it perfectly. Katharina is an amazing advocate for sanitation and water, and is doing a great job with their colleagues of moving this agenda forward. And in Power, People and Planet, in this podcast series, what I'm trying to do is make the argument that what is needed is a new eco-social contract. Okay, what do I mean by that? By a social contract, simply, we need to reevaluate and reaffirm and clarify what are the agreements and expectations that citizens can have of their governments. What is a contract between citizens, people, and their governments, right? And that social contract, some people say, is broken, as if it got broken just yesterday. Some people say it's always been broken for Indigenous peoples, for women, for young people, for minorities of various kinds and so on. But yet other people say, no, the system is not broken. The system was designed to be exactly as it is, and it's delivering, because the system was designed to benefit the few at the expense of the majority. And so in that sense, I think we are at a moment where, even though we might not agree with people sitting in different parts of society, like government, business, civil society, and so on, I am still a passionate believer that it's better for us to talk, provided the talk is purposeful, transparent, inclusive, to seek solutions. But I think many of our leaders need to understand that they are losing the patience of young people, and I cannot say that I blame them.
And Kuminedo, to keep this type of transparency and to keep a very meaningful dialogue, you have, in addition to this podcast called Power, People and Planet, you have involvement in the Robert Butch Academy as a fellow. Can you tell us a little bit more about it?
Yes, I've just arrived here in Berlin to take up this fellowship. It's one of those fellowships we don't apply for, but you approached. And I was very lucky to be approached to spend a couple months here and to choose what I wanted to work on. And the two things that I'm working on is, one, asking the question, why is activism failing? Because activism is doing many good things, and it's certainly making things would be much worse without activism. But activism at the moment is winning battles, but is losing the overall war for justice, peace, and development. And therefore, this is not a moment for timidness in our analysis. This is a moment for brutal honesty and for us to recognize that we need to ask ourselves some deep questions, like what should we stop doing, what should we continue doing, but do it in a different way, what should we start doing that we're not doing, and so on. So I don't know the answers to the question, but I think I have some indications. And one of the answers to the question, though, is that activism must communicate in more people-friendly, accessible ways. So I'm spending half my time working with an amazing artist here called Olofor Eliasson on exploring the question of how we can bring the world of art and activism and the world of arts and culture and the world of activism to support each other and to work more meaningfully together, what some call artivism. So just to be clear, it's not about trying to get arts and culture to, you know, as some used to say during the struggle in South Africa, be the tool of the liberation struggle. In fact, we need arts and culture to also hold up a mirror to activism when activism is failing and activism is experiencing contradictions and so on.
I was going to talk about it. There is no synonym to the word synonym, but there is a synonym to activism, which is artivism. And from what I've understood, it's a way to touch more people and have a wider impact and audience.
Absolutely. And you know, if I look at what I learned from my childhood activism, I lived in a country where the majority of our people couldn't read and write. And so to mobilize and organize people, you couldn't just write leaflets in English and expect people to understand what you were talking about. So, you know, we had to use arts, culture, music, song, dance, theater as ways of communicating. We were forced not to speak in ways that were too intellectual and too much of jargon and so on, and in ways in which, you know, ordinary people could be part of the conversation. Because the problem is people are being made spectators in a game that they need to be centrally involved in. The scale of the problem requires that kind of participation and rigorousness. Let me give you a story just to make the point, right? It might get a bit lost, but let me try. So when I was on a little inflatable boat going to occupy an oil rig in Greenland in 2011, and the sea was very rough and I was quite nervous, and my colleagues noticed it, and I was nervous because I don't swim very well. In fact, I don't swim well at all. One of my colleagues says to me, "Oh, Kumino, don't worry. Yeah, if you fall into this ocean, what you're wearing, you'll survive for at least 2 hours and we'll be able to fish you out." because if you fell with normal swimming gear, you would be dead in 5 minutes because of hypothermia. This is the Arctic Ocean. And I looked at the waves and thought, shoo, I could fall in here and I'll be here for a couple of hours. Will they find me? And then I thought, if this was the last thing I did in my life, and I looked at the poster that I was carrying and it said, "Stop Arctic Destruction." Right? Now, 99.99% of my family, friends, and colleagues back in Africa wouldn't know what that slogan meant. You know? Especially then. Now more people understand that the Arctic is the refrigerator and air conditioner of the planet, and it takes the harsh edge of this sun's rays and reflects it back into the atmosphere and so on. But that time, there was very limited consciousness about it. And so when I got out of, I was arrested for that action. I spent a week in prison in Greenland, and when I eventually got home and I was talking to some kids in the family, and they were saying to me, you know, what would have been a better slogan is not save, stop Arctic destruction, but a better slogan would have been save Santa Claus now. You know why? That's the only association that ordinary people have with that part of the world, the North Pole, you know, Santa Claus is. Well, I'll just assure your listeners, I know that Santa Claus doesn't exist. But sometimes good activism is not about projecting your own consciousness on the people that you're trying to mobilize. It's about understanding where people are, what knowledge they have, how can we build on that knowledge, and how we can move them to a greater level of awareness and understanding so that they will be moved to take action, to stand up and fight for that which is in their own interest.
Kuminedo, you also have a very busy agenda, and I'm wondering, what is your plan for the year that is coming very soon, 2022? Because, of course, there will be the COP 27 in Egypt, but I believe that the rest of the year you are into the fight.
Yes, so I'm wanting to do some work on trying to stimulate a debate on and discussion and hopefully movement forward on how we can rethink activism and how can we be more bolder and more courageous and so on. That's one. Second is I'm wanting to continue to work on bringing the arts and culture and activist communities together in what little way I can. And I will be focused on what's happening, you know, with the COP next year in Egypt. But I also will be doing everything as a citizen of South Africa to help defeat the efforts of Shell to start, firstly, a seismic exploration on the Eastern Cape from the region where Mandela grew up, and with the hope of doing drilling for oil or gas in the oceans of Mandela's home. And I'm one of the things I'm very committed to is supporting young people. So I will continue to behind the scenes support young people who reach out for engagement around. In fact, I say to young people, I don't know why you'll invite people like me. And then I say, well, the only good thing we can do is we can tell you how we failed, and and you all can try and figure out how to win. Because, you know, the truth is, you know, you introduced me in a very kind way, as everybody does. Seriously speaking, you could have introduced me in a different way. You could say, well, this guy Kuminedo has been around, he's done this, he's done that, but actually has very, very little to show for it. All the problems seem to still be there. And you know, that's what I say this only part in jest. This is not a moment, honestly, for us to be worried about legacies and our own egos and all.
Wow.
Now is the time to say that there's a clock that is ticking. The climate struggle, unlike gender equality, poverty, and all the other horrible things that we've been fighting for, has one thing that's different. There's nothing telling us we have to solve gender equality by a certain date, even though we should have some decades ago. But with climate, there's a science telling us we are running out of time. And every year, every month, you know, every hour we delay, we are playing political poker, not with the future of the planet, but the future of our children and their children. And the good news is we have now the statistical majority of people in the world who are willing to fight for a safe climate future, but we have to now get them to be more active, and we also have to start building solutions from bottom up so that we make it irresistible for our governments not to be able to move with courage and ambition way beyond what they articulated at the climate negotiations in Glasgow.
and Kuminedu to make it irresistible for the youth and young generation to join the movement that you are involved in. Do you have any pieces of advice and messages to conclude this 1 hour conversation? Because I was born in 2002, so I'm also part of this generation.
So, firstly, I would say to young people, resist the notion when people in my generation say to you, young people are the leaders of tomorrow. If you wait for tomorrow, there will not be a future for you to take leadership in. You've got to step forward and take leadership now. Secondly, what we need from young people is many things, but I think most important is we need the freshness of their lenses, right? What I mean by that, they need to bring fresh eyes to old problems, because otherwise, I believe my generation will continue to go round and round in circles and do the same thing over and over again, as Einstein said, expecting to get different results, and that's just not good enough. The third thing I say to young people is, it's sad and it's not fair that you are left with having to fight the struggle and for you to give up parts of your childhood. But make sure you hold on to your childhood. Don't lose it. And make sure that the way in which you participate in the struggle for your future, you do it with love, with happiness, with a sense of community with the other young people that you're involved in. What I would say to you is, having been involved in the struggle for justice for more than 40 years, I can safely say to you that if I contributed this much to the struggle, then I got this much back. I can tell you that leading a purposeful life and fighting a good fight for your future and doing it in a peaceful, dignified, and just way is something that will make you a better person, but will also help you secure your future and the future of your children. But please make sure you sing, dance, laugh through it all. Don't give the benefit for those that have governed with indifference and with cruelty to take that one thing away from you: your ability to have a childhood, to have teenage years, and to also be able to smile and laugh and be strong and stand on your feet while we fight the biggest struggle of all time, which is to avert life-threatening, catastrophic, runaway, irreversible climate change.
Perfect, Kuminedu. I'm going to dance under the Montreal snow. Thank you so much for your time, your energy, and I'm looking forward to chat again in the future.
Thank you very, very much. Thank you.